study that I did together with the colleagues from the Netherlands. And because there are no real theories about trilateral based on the meta-analysis that I actually did myself earlier. What is a trilateral retinoblastoma? You probably all know it. It's a hereditary retinoblastoma that can be bilateral, unilateral, or in very rare cases, no retinal tumors at all, combined with a midline primitive neuroplastic tumor in the intracranial space, and about 3/4 of them are in the pineal glands, and 1/4 is in the suprasella location, close to the optic chiasm. And this is probably because the pineal gland is a photosensitive organ, so we have there always tissue that resembles the photoreceptors in the retina. But why do we have the tumors in the suprasellar area? My understanding is that during embryonic development, there is migration of the retinal unlagged cells in this area. And there are papers that show that there can be vestiges of the migrating cells in this area. So probably this tumor starts in the cells in transit to wet the retina during development. And these are detected earlier than this time, probably for the same reason. They are cells that resemble more the cells in the retina than what the cells in the pineal gland do.
What about the four last percent?
What is?
It makes 98-96%.
There are rare cases that are described as trilateral retinoblastomas that are located elsewhere in the brain than in these two locations. But their true identity is a little bit uncertain. As far as I know, there has not yet been a report of a child that would have both types simultaneously. Until now it has always been either one, but it's only a matter of time when there will be a paper from a child that has both types of net. It would then be a quadrilateral retinoblastoma. There has been a paper on that publication where there was a pineal cyst, but that was a benign tumor that we see rather often in young children now that MRI is done more and more often to various conditions. So, I originally published about this in 1999. At that time, there were 106 trilateral retinoblastomas. That was published in Journal of Clinical Oncology, and it's been cited more than 100 times. So, I did it because I myself didn't really know what to do with these tumors. But apparently, other readers have found the paper useful as well. In meetings of the International Society of Ocular Oncology, I presented an update in 2007 and in 2012, and the number had increased to 186 children. And in this latest meta-analysis, it was 174, and it is smaller than there because the Dutch wanted to limit to papers in the English language. So the difference is the trilateral cases reported in French, German, Italian, and other languages. And that was accepted to the Lancet Oncology as a rapid publication paper by the selection of the editor. There is a difference in the clinical presentation, not just in the location between the pineal and the suprasellar net. The pineal tumors, until now at least, have more often been symptomatic because they develop a little bit later. They are not always spotted at the same time than the retinal tumors, and they lead to obstructive hydrocephalus that develops general symptoms in the child, such as nausea, lethargy, some positive neurological symptoms. Whereas those that are located in the suprasellar area may lead to early visual loss because of compression of the optic chiasm, and they are detected faster and often, as in this instance, at a time when there is active tumor in the retina. When is the diagnosis made? In this analysis, we divided cases that were diagnosed before 1995 and after 1995. The divisions were made because approximately at this time, people started to use high-dose chemotherapy with stem cell rescue for the treatment. And also, MRI was routinely done at the time of diagnosis of the intraocular disease. And now, after 1995, 50% are found in the first magnetic resonance imaging, as you can see here. And the last case is found after 4.5 years on diagnosis. So if you wish to screen for this, it's no use to screen past 5 years. But it's a matter of debate whether it's cost effective. If you calculate that you only have 50% of these rare tumors to detect after your first MRI, and that they can sometimes be very quickly growing, you end up with doing approximately 2,000 MRIs to find one case. And at the moment, we can cure half of the patients that we find. But there are many who argue that you shouldn't screen because that's not cost effective and you are likely to miss a tumor. Or even if you find it earlier, you cannot save the life. But for the better or worse, in Helsinki we have now done the MRI every 4 months during the first year and every 6 months afterwards. But I don't yet know of a publication that would show detection of a net in a screening MRI without symptoms after the initial diagnosis. But if you want to screen, you have essentially zero risk after 5 years. That's good to know. Is trilateral retinoblastoma different from the usual hereditary form? It's not. Because according to literature, you have unilateral disease in approximately 14% of cases as an aggregate of several studies. You have unilateral retinoblastoma with a trilateral tumor in 16%, bilateral in 81% of the cases, and in 82% bilateral with trilateral. And no tumor in the eye, partial sense in the general, and these are the asymptomatic carriers. Two children, 2% with trilateral tumor only. So no difference in the phenotype of the eyes. What about the outcome? The survival has dramatically increased since 1995. It's almost 50%, 48% to be exact, who seem to survive. And as we see, we have several long-term survivors after 5 years from treatment that seem to be cured of trilateral disease. Whereas before 1995, there were hardly anyone who survived. The green line is cases where it is unclear whether the treatment was before or after 1995.
So are those in the blue line, did they all get stem cell high-dose chemo and rescue?
We'll come to that. They are mostly high-dose chemo with stem cell rescue, almost exclusive. But there are a few cases in which additional radiation was given and cases where additional radiation was not given. And there are cases that biopsied almost completely before the treatment and cases that were not touched by surgery. So there is much variation within that curve, even though the chemotherapy was higher with stem cell rescue. So we can divide these into pineals. The pineals, probably because they are diagnosed a little later. So we have 44% survival for pineal at 5 years, and only 6% before 1995. For the suprachiasmatic tumors, we now have 57% survival, where it was nil 5 years before. So here the treatment paradigm change to high-dose chemotherapy really has made a difference. And again, this may also indicate that because they develop earlier and they are more reminiscent of the retinal tumor in the suprachiasmatic area, they also have a more favorable response to chemotherapy. Is there any predictor of survival? There are some associated findings. The survival improvement depends to some extent not only on the treatment regimen, but also that the tumors are found early, as I showed in the previous slide. So 70% now survive if they are treated before any symptoms develop. And of course, these are mostly the cases that have the tumor at the same time when they intraocular disease. But even if there is symptoms, one third of the children survive past 5 years, although that is only based on 4 cases. Also, the chemotherapy is able to cure tumors that were incurable before 1995. And in the original paper, I made a division at 15 millimeter size, because there was no one that survived with a tumor bigger than 15 millimeter, whereas approximately 25% at that time survived if the tumor was smaller than 15 millimeters. But now we see that if the tumor is less than 15, there is 65% survival. But even when the tumor is bigger than 15, there is 50% survival red line. The big difference for better also in this regard. If you have tumor spread along the neuraxis, the prognosis is expected the worst. If there is no spread axis, it's about 70% who are cured. And again, it's about one third, even if there is spread with the cerebrospinal fluid to the medulla.
Does that treatment include intrathecal chemotherapy?
In those cases, yes. But what's the effect of the intrathecal compared with the high dose is unsure, because we have a long history of giving intrathecal treatment for leptomeningeal spread usually was not effective. So, we don't know exactly how this should be treated, but we know that surgery alone, of course, is not sufficient. Chemotherapy is absolutely needed, and typically it should today be a high dose with stem cell rescue and later replacement of the bone marrow. But there is no consistent protocol among the long-term survivors. There have been many different protocols given with approximately the same result. What's also open is the role of the adjuvant radiotherapy, but our recommendation in Helsinki has been to give it, because we know from the eye that the chemotherapy alone very often fails to control the tumor completely. But there is no consensus about this. I knew Francis gave high-dose chemotherapy to the one child without radiation therapy. I had to give the radiation therapy later for recurrence in one case.
We have one case with a very large initial tumor, which is in our nature reduced disease primer. And that child was a long-term cure with no radiotherapy.
There are also other cases in which there was only chemotherapy without radiation and a long-term cure.
Yeah.
So it happens, but in what percentage, we don't know. So there is an example from Helsinki. We had this child with a big supracellular tumor detected at baseline. The macula was probably surviving on the top of the tumor in that eye. And we have completed inner detachment without a visible optic disc and macula in this eye, with apparently through and through the retina infiltration in the right eye. So high-dose chemotherapy was given, stem cell rescue was done, then an even higher dose replacement of the bone marrow, and the tumor had shrunk to a small remnant, and we gave stereotactic radiotherapy at this point. And so this is the outcome 5 years after treatment. The macula just survived with 24 division, in spite of the total retinal detachment in the beginning. But we only have counting fingers vision in this, but probably the retinocytoma-like part of the tumor is remaining. And no visibility of the tumor, but there is hypopituitary that needs hormone replacement therapy.
I have a question. For the big mass in rhino, and how do you rule out the metastatic?
How do you rule out?
I mean, it's not metastatic mass, is it?
But it's not from the IV.
Yeah.
You're asking, is it to show it's not intracranial retinoblastoma?
We checked the bone marrow so that there was no hematodendrous metastasis. We checked the optic nerves, that there is no involvement for the optic nerves.
Okay.
And it's a single lesion in the typical place where you expect the trilateral tumor to develop. It's a combination of factors. And I think most would agree that it's a trilateral tumor, not a metastasis. So this girl is doing drawings. She always brings a drawing to me. She's riding a pony and is living what seems to be a pretty typical life for a 7-year-old girl. So does chemoreduction prevent trilateral retinoblastoma? We had such a paper from Philadelphia at one time pointing out that in the chemoreduction group, they had 99 patients and expected to observe from 5 to 15 trilaterals, and they observed none. Whereas in the non-chemoreduction group, in 18 cases, they expected 1 to 3 cases and had 1. But I don't think this is true. First of all, 50% of the tumors are diagnosed before chemoreduction. So it's very unusual that they had no trilaterals in 99 cases, because we would expect that half of these 5 to 15 would have been detectable at baseline. Somehow those patients were not referred to the series. And in this meta-analysis with the Dutch colleagues, there were 9 children who developed a trilateral tumor after chemoreduction. So now we know officially that it doesn't prevent trilateral disease. If you want, there is a lot more data in this original paper, and it's supplementary data. So if you are interested about this very interesting manifestation of retinoblastoma, you can read that in detail. And the paper promised to sending the important files to everyone on this course, and I'll be happy to give a PDF copy of this paper to
yet
batch of information for everyone. Thank you.